Hello and welcome to our worship today on this third Sunday in Advent. As we come ever closer now to Christmas Day, just 2 weeks away roughly now, when we come together, wherever we are, to celebrate the birth of Jesus. God with us, Emmanuel. I hope you've had a good week, despite the weather, which has been pretty cold these last few days. And yet the skies have been bright despite that. And something about that sunshine and that brightness in the air lifts our spirits still in some way, doesn't it? Despite maybe the moments of gloom that they also seem to be around us in these tricky times. Tricky times that maybe resonate still with the times of when Jesus, of course, came into the world. This third Sunday of Advent is when we light a third candle. And that third candle is often pink in colour, different from the purple of the other periods, of the other Sundays, should I say. And that pink colour expresses something to us different. It's there to symbolise and express joy. And something of that joy will run through our reading and our theme today. So wherever you are, let's just take a few moments now just to be still, to be ready to be met by the living Lord, coming as we are, to bring ourselves in as an offering in his service and to receive his grace, his love and his joy in a way that makes a difference to who we are and how we live day by day. So let us now just be still. O come, Emmanuel, come, Lord Jesus, and meet with us today as we come to praise you, to worship you, as we come expectant of your coming amongst us at Christmas, to receive you afresh into our hearts and our lives, into our beings, that makes a difference to who we are, so that we can be a part of your work in seeking lives to be touched and changed by your grace, to be a part of your work in continuing to change the world and seeing your kingdom come. We ask this, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen. No doubt we come before the Lord, God who is love, conscious of those things where we know we haven't loved as he has called us to love. Let us just come as we are, bringing those things as we are. Again, let's pause for a few moments to reflect on those things. Lord, we come to you as we are. We know that we so readily go our own ways in our lives. We hear your call to follow you, to follow your way of life and love. But too often we go our own selfish way deliberately in our thoughts, in all different kinds of ways that we know doesn't do justice to you or to ourselves. And so we come before you, Lord, and we ask for your forgiveness, for your cleansing, your healing, and a fresh start today, a new beginning. Strengthen us, Lord, to follow your way and your path. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And so may you know, Almighty God, the God who is love, the God who is grace and mercy and peace, may you know his forgiveness and healing and his pardon today. Amen. And now let's just continue in our worship by lifting our voices in praise.
Thank you.
And our reading today comes from the Old Testament, from the book of Isaiah, reading from chapter 35. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it. The splendour of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendour of our God. Strengthen the feeble hands. Steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. In the haunts where jackals once lay, grass and reeds and papyrus will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the Way of Holiness. The unclean will not journey on it. It will be for those who walk in that way. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there, nor will any ferocious beast get up on it. They will not be found there. But only the redeemed will walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So let us pray. Lord Jesus, speak to us now by your Spirit. Help us to hear what you are saying at this time in a way that makes a difference to who we are and how we live our lives in your service. In your name we pray. Amen. As you heard that passage being read, I wonder what struck you. One of the things that really strikes me is the imagery, the very poetic imagery that speaks about places that were dead or seen as being dead, almost given up on, have come back to life. It reminds me that there's in the United States, I think it's called Death Valley, which is, as it says, really a place where everybody assumes everything is dead. There's no life. And yet once in a while, all of a sudden, a cloud will come across and rain will fall. And once the rain has fallen, people are amazed that all of a sudden what appears is like a carpet of colour on the ground as long dormant seeds burst into life. The most unexpected image and the most unexpected reality. But that's what this passage in many ways is portraying. That sense of that which was, you could almost say, given up on as fruitless, dried up land, coming back to life in this powerful, unexpected way and pointing to the glory of God coming. There's something very maybe disturbing at times in the imagery where it speaks about your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come. We don't like that kind of image, really. And maybe at times the language even seems to be rather harsh. But does it not point to the reality that there are people in all times who needs saving? savouring from the kind of situations they find themselves in. And it means that God does not give up on us, particularly when there are moments when we really do encounter and we see evil at work, injustices being done to people. And of course, we see that and we hear that constantly, don't we, day by day in the news that we hear. And sometimes we can wonder, or I certainly wonder, when will that come to an end? When will those who choose that path of destruction and evil finally have their day of reckoning? And this passage here, these moments here, talk about that and tell us that one day God will finally deal with that and destroy all of that evil. But even as we wait, he is still at work through people to stand up and say what is right and what is wrong. And there is this clash that we see so often, isn't there, between, yeah, forces of good and evil battling out to see and justice and freedom come forth. And there's maybe a part towards the end that similarly maybe is a bit unexpected for some, when it talks about a highway being there, but it's called the way of holiness, where the unclean, as it's put here, will not travel. Those in the sense who have not chosen to go God's way, to go God's path, they will not find it. They will not be in it, because in many ways, that's not the path that they've chosen. It will be those who are described as being the redeemed who will walk there. Those who have been forgiven. Those who have been accepted by the Lord, who have accepted the Lord's grace and forgiveness. And maybe some of those knowing that they don't deserve that in any shape or form because of what they do and have done in their lives. And I say they, but of course that applies to all of us, because we all carry that within us, don't we? That sense of the great potential for good, but still that propensity and desire often just to go our own ways rather than God's ways. But as we allow ourselves to be constantly challenged and renewed by God's Spirit at work within us, so steadily our lives can continue to be redeemed. But it's speaking about those who are on that journey as being the ones who will here enter with singing everlasting joy with that crown upon their heads. That's not to say that we don't, or that God doesn't want everybody to be in that place of enjoying that joy. Far from it. I think the Lord looks upon those who choose to go their way rather than his way, who choose still to perpetrate injustice and evil upon others. He looks upon them with deep sadness and regret, and longs for them still to turn, repent and choose his way of love, peace and grace. And of course, there may be instances when we can think of particular characters and we might think, well, surely, Lord, they're beyond the pale now. But for the Lord, no one is necessarily beyond the pale, even if they have done the most appalling of deeds at times. There is still always that way in which God's grace and mercy will always and should always scandalize us in some way. And yet if we can see with the Lord's eyes, to see somebody's life so touched and changed in some way, surely that might amaze us, but also cause us to rejoice with joy. I can't help today but feel a measure of joy too, knowing about the situation of one particular family who are arriving in our midst even today, knowing the difficulties and despair that they may well have experienced in recent months, and yet arriving amongst us to the hope of a new life, new starts, and the sense of joy and hope for them that there must be in that sense of hope, even amidst the uncertainty. And the joy that I feel also somehow in being heartened by the response of people in our communities towards those who have experienced this. And may this just be one instance where we are able to be generous, but may it not be the last. I don't know how your situation is, and maybe this whole idea of joy is just difficult. But remember, joy is not the same as happiness. Joy somehow is something that is stirred up within us as we realize that God is at work in our midst, as we look to Him rather than our circumstances to be the foundation of our lives. The joy comes from knowing that the Lord Jesus is in our midst, that He is at work to bring forth life from the parched places and the deserts. He started that work. He's still at work. It's yet to be fully complete, but we can rejoice that He is with us, and that one day, it will truly come to pass. Amen. And so let us pray. Almighty God, who through the prophets promised that light would conquer the darkness, shine in our hearts and in our minds, and so work within us that we may lead others to your splendour and to the greatness of your power that we see revealed in your Son Jesus, who lives with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. And so come, Lord God, give strength to the hands that are tired and to the knees that tremble with weakness. For you are the God who cares for all who are down. You come down to where we are to uplift us. For you are the God who gives us hope, who comes to fill us with joy. Lord, as your church, may we travel this road of holiness. May we grow in faith, grow in love, and grow in our fruitfulness as we deepen our roots in you. We pray for the churches within our benefice as we seek to bless our communities, to serve them, and to share the good news of Jesus amongst them. Help us to find that way to proclaim your good news in our communities. But help us in so doing to look to you for our help and our strength. Lord, we remember before you those who are discouraged and fearful, especially at this time, for all whose freedom is limited by tyranny and war, for all those whose lives are restricted by poverty, for all those who are abused by those who choose to exercise power unjustly and unfairly, and for all whose dreams have been destroyed in some way. Lord, you are the God who gives us hope. And as we reflect on the images in this reading that we have heard today, We pray for the time when the lame will leap for joy, when the deaf will hear, when the blind will be able to see, when the dumb will shout your praise, when the handicapped will find freedom, when sorrow and grief are done away, and all will sing and shout for joy. And we pray, Lord, at this time for the end of war and conflict and division between people, as individuals, as communities, as cultures, as nations. We pray for your peace, your reconciliation, for justice, and for those who are the peacemakers. And now, Lord, we pray for those who are on our hearts at this time, those who are sick or unwell in any shape or form, body, mind or spirit, asking for your healing power to be at work in their lives. For you are the God who gives us hope and fills us with joy. You are the Lord who comes to save and rescue us. And so come, Lord Jesus. Come, O come, Emmanuel. And help us to receive your life deep within us. Help us to receive your spirit so that we may overflow with your hope, your love, and your joy. And we bring these prayers to a close as we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Thank you again for being with us in our time of worship today. And as we look forward to the coming days, as we count down, if you like, now to Christmas Day, may we, as we reflect day by day, may we find hope and may we know something of God's joy in our lives, despite the circumstances around us, as we look to Him and as we root ourselves in Him and draw upon His love and His grace to enable us to take each day as it comes and to rejoice in the fact that the Lord is with us. And so we close our time with the words of this blessing, which come from our reading last week from chapter 15 of Romans. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all those you know, love, care for, pray for, this day and evermore. Amen. And so go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Have a good week, everybody, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. And yes, may you be someone who, knowing that sense of bubbling hope and joy within you, is able to go out and share something of that with somebody this week. Bye for now. See you soon.